IOTOP run from the sysadmin domain. Let's have a look at that. There was this question on the mail list and Bugzilla. So yeah, first thing I guess I need to do is set up a sysadmin user. So basically, let's just as you manage user list, see how the user mappings are currently configured, and if see whether stuff user identity is actually associated to sysadmin. And I need to actually use a shell, SSH shell, because this is unreadable for me. So let's just do that first. Whoops. Oh no. Hopefully it's still recording. It seems to be still recording. That's with these key combinations, when you hit a wrong key then. And I shouldn't use this, but no, it's not gonna happen. Is it 247 SSH root at 192.168.1.2.2.247? Probably not. Nope. So let's get the IP address. IP address shoe. And it's actually, it is 247, so why in the hell can I not, oh yeah, 2168, that's why. ABC123, so as you manage user list, and stuff is actually associated to the sysadmin role. So I need to actually add a user, user add, and then I could, but I won't associate that directly to star view, but I won't, because it somehow there's some weird behavior if you use user add with the capital Z option. So user, my admin, I guess, password, my admin, and then ABC123. ABC123, and then basically map associate add associate to star view, and with a range of S0 S0 C1 C102 C0 C1023, and then actually my admin is the name of the user, and that adds a mapping. And then I need to set up sudo, I guess, because everything works with sudo. So cd etc sudoers d, and I'll just do it the quick way, nano my admin, and then it's basically my admin, and I'm just all is all. I would have made this more specific, but sysadmin role, type actually role, sysadmin role, sysadmin role, and that's actually all for everything. And then tmod 0440, because else it's going to be unhappy. And let's just see if that works. SSH, and then my admin at 192.168.1.2.2.247, and then ABC123 ID stuff sudo shell, or actually sudo IDZ ABC123, and I'm just admin. Alright, so that works. So yeah, let's just stay logged in here. So this IOTOP thingy, IOTOP, it's not installed, of course. Yum, what provides, and then IOTOP. Now hopefully it's actually available. And I see I don't have EPL installed. And it might actually be in EPL. No, actually not. So it's called IOTOP, so yum install IOTOP. Now the idea was that it didn't work by default. So let's just do an RPM query list IOTOP just to see what's in there. And it's just a user bin utility, so I guess from that perspective, unprivileged users should be able to run that. So, but let's just run it as root now to see what it does. And it's just a top kind of thing, but then with the IO listed, which is nice. You can do some nice things there with a simple bash script. You can basically do some nice stuff in there. So that's basically it. So man IO top. Let's see what kind of options we have. We don't have man installed. But there seems to be no. Oh yeah, there is a man page, but it's man one. Weird. Let's just yum install man. Hopefully, it doesn't install too many dependencies, and then man IO top. So what kind of options do we have? We have version, help, only show processes or threads actually doing IO, batch, turn on non-interactive mode, useful for logging IO over time, so that's basically for scripts, I guess. And then you have the number of iterations before quitting, delay, list users, only show processes, kilobytes time, and that's it. So there aren't any many options. So so what this guy was actually telling me was that it doesn't work for sysadmin. So let's just sudo shell and then abc123. Oh, I don't have to. IDZ get enforce. It's enforcing, so he says it doesn't work. And permission denied, so it doesn't actually work. And that's fine, that's not fine, that's... The question is, should this just work? Exit. IDZ. And let's just see if this works. This doesn't work either. So yeah, this should probably just have a policy, I guess. So let's just create a policy for it. And it's really just simple, basically. We have this, and I'll just do that in my other shell here. CD, PWD. So make their IO top. CD IO top. So I was telling this guy, hey, you should look at the DMI decode module and just use that as inspiration. So that's basically what I'm going to do here. So DMI decode, where are you? Because yeah, you shouldn't reinvent the wheel. No need. So just copy this over and nano IO top TE, paste that in and just remove the stuff that we don't want to do by default. And actually this one, the latest one, is pretty damn obvious. So, and actually there might be other obvious shit in there as well, but anyways, IO top. This one is obvious because yeah, it needs to actually put that output on your terminal, on your screen. So IO top. And then IO top. And IO top. IO top. tabletop. And I see that it's not specified as a user DOM user application domain. I'm not sure what the reason for that is. But let's just keep it like this for now, because yeah, it's also can be run from a system service or some system process. So IO top. So let's just keep it the way it is. IO top. And then IO top version 100. That's basically. Let's skim over it. Yeah, this looks good. So save that. Let's just do the interface file as well. Same stuff. Just copy it over and then just edit it. Because this app has pretty much the same characteristics. Now paste that in and then just man IO top to get the description. We want to do it nice because we think about the people that actually want to use some of these APIs that we're creating for them. We want to make it nice for them. We think about how others use our policy, so to speak. So it's execute iotop in the iotop domain. And this is a simple domain transition, IO top, and then it's called IO top DOM trans, IO top DOM trans, and then you have here the IO top T type, IO top T, and here you have IO top exact T, and IO top exact T, IO top T. And then here you have the execute iotop in the iotop domain. And additionally, allow the specified role the iotop domain. This is basically just the DOM trans with an additional set of rules that allows the role access, the calling role access to the iotop domain. And this should probably be sufficient for this app, and I might be wrong, and if I'm wrong then I'm gonna have to rethink it, but this is a solid start for me, I think. It's a solid base. So this seems to be set up properly. Let's edit the file context file, and it's basically single line user bin iotop. I can just basically type that in. User bin iotop and then gen context system u object r and then iotop exact t and then the no categories and no sensitivities. So yeah, that's, oh actually I need to put a new line here, but it probably already did that. Yeah, it already did that, so. So let's just edit the type enforcement. Let's just not do that, that's fine. Make, and before we do the make dance, let's just also create a my sysadmin, because we're going to have to call this for sysadmin. But policy module, but we can't actually edit the existing sysadmin module because and I call it my sysadmin, but we just create an add-on module just for testing purposes, and then optional policy, and I need to actually require some stuff before I do that, but I can do that actually inside gen require. And then just require the type and the role type sysadmin t and role sysadmin r. and then just close that, and then just call the iotop run, and it's expecting two parameters, sysadmin t is the first parameter, and the role sysadmin role is the second parameter, and that should take care of that. Let's just see if this all builds. Make f user share as in Linux devel, make file, and we have some stuff here. We have a syntax error at token attribute role. In the iotop.te file. Now, that's weird, but it might actually be attribute role. This might actually be because the make file doesn't understand it or some for some reason. Because it looks good to me, but it at the same time it's just basically complaining for some reason, and it says syntax error, isn't it? So yeah, it says syntax error for attribute role iotop role. So I'm just imagining this is Red Hat Enterprise Linux 6, and this shit is not implemented in Red Hat Enterprise Linux 6, so we need to basically do a fallback. So I'll just comment out the stuff that doesn't apply to Red Hat Enterprise Linux 6. So role system R types IO top T, so that system that the system can run can eventually transition to it if needed. So that's that, and then the interface file needs to be edited as well. So this is just a compatibility issue. We just basically added role types here, role, and then it was two types, and iotop.t, and then for good measure add type in the required block, type iotop.t. So yeah, there's this compatibility issue with Red Hat Enterprise Linux 6, but this should work in Fedora. And now it builds. So SE module insert or install my sysadmin pp and iotop pp. Just installing it. Takes a while on Red Hat Enterprise Linux 6, unfortunately. For some reason, that slipped the cracks. Oh. And then just basically relabel that file, that user bin iotop file. And then the transition should occur for sysadmin. And then we can... Actually, what do I have here? We have, oh, yeah, no. Why is that? Oh, yeah, I see a typo. So yeah, that shit happens. But there's a typo there. File context file. And it's not gen context, it's gen context. So that's where it's basically messed up. And then just do it again. Patience is a virtue. Let's go, let's go, let's go, go. So yeah, there's quite a few differences with the Red Hat Enterprise Linux 6 and this and Fedora. So restore con, and then it's basically I'll just do a verbose user bin iotop. It's reset to iotop exactly. So now sysadmin should domain transition to the iotop domain when it runs that. And then now we basically need to make the iotop domain sufficient. So I'm interested to see what it actually needs. Center force zero, whether it actually needs to create some user files or anything. TS recent, just to make sure that we're clear. So let's just ID. I'm sysadmin, so let's just run it iotop. And we're in permissive mode, right? So this is just troubleshooting, or actually troubleshooting, this development mode. So is there some functions that I can do? No. Let's just do the out, so it's MIC recent again, and then just out to allow it first, so have an overview of what it needs. So yeah, what it basically does is the following. It's actually running a shell, and what it does is actually it's reading all the processing state files. So there's, and we can see which file that actually is, but it probably does that to find the IO. And then on top of that, it reads generic proc files, and it actually does a DEC override, and that's because I'm running it from my home directory, and that's usual, so that's basically why you want a DEC override. And then it's doing a netadmin, which is weird, but it's probably for iSCSI or something like that, I'm not sure. But I guess. And here we have it setting, getting scheduler information for init. We have init reading reading init state, and it actually, so basically it wants to get scheduler information of any process. That's what basically a guess that I'm making, but I see it returning a couple times here, audit and for DHCPC. And so, and it might just, and kernel actually, was it for init as well? Yeah, and init as well. So yeah, it probably needs to be able to get scheduler information for any process. So yeah, blah, 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 blah. And then actually, so those are all the processing files. So let's just have a look at the raw IOVC now, to see what we can determine from that. So for example, here it is, reading generic proc file, so it's just, that's just a shell basically. Well, iotop as well, but basically it's not the shell, it's iotop itself. It's reading proc mem info, so it's trying to determine memory information. Then it's reading localization, basically locale archive, basically localization information. Here is the full path to that locale stuff. And then it's actually seems to be running locale or not. Not really, but it gets attributes of it. Maybe later it's running it. And here it's actually running bash. Can you believe that? So iotop is actually running bash. And then you have the DEC override, and this is actually because I'm running it from my user home directory, which is basically owned by has basically the bit set to 700, so that means that only the owner can actually traverse it, and this is actually root, so that's why root needs DEC override. And we have here, it's actually executing a file called the shell. So it's the things that do you use a bench file, some help application. And here it's actually creating that netlink route socket, and it's just probably reading a routing table, creating netlink socket. And here it's reading proc again, but this is actually the root dir on the proc file system. And here it's actually getting task information, and it's reading state of PID1, which is init. And so it's actually reading the task file, and I'm not sure, but there's that's probably where it gets that information from, that iotop information from proc BID task or whatever. Or maybe it's probably something like that. And that's basically the bulk of the stuff that it's doing. It's just reading proc files and then just doing stuff. So here we have that netadmin, and this is a bit weird. The netadmin stuff. We have here, it's reading this CMD line. This is probably also in proc, isn't it? Yeah, this is actually also in proc. This is the kernel CMD line, it's reading it. This is it, isn't it? Yeah, this is it, actually. Proc 384 CMD line. And that's basically what it does on the screen. It basically prints the current command, actually, that's executed. Or something like that. But anyways, that's the bulk of the stuff here. And DHCP, so it's getting scheduler information and reading process state of basically all processes on the system. So yeah, we got the whole main deal. So now actually we can just write the policy. It doesn't do anything scary or anything. It's pretty simple. So let's just copy this over into our module, into our IOTOP type enforcement file. And then just basically, and there was already this rule here, which we added in because I know that it needs that. So let's just translate some of this stuff. So first of all, it wants to read kernel read system states. It wants to read proc mem info, kernel read system state. So IO top T. So I can remove the lines with regards to proc T. Where are you? Here. These are now taken care of. It wants to actually, let's just add those in right away. It wants to execute generic binaries and the bash shell. Binaries like user bin file, and there might be some other generic binaries. Core, command, exec, bin, iotop, t. And core command exec shell, which is basically needed to run the shells in the calling domain, in the iotop domain. So we're running the shell with the permissions of iotop. We can remove these. And then the shell lines, where are you? Shell exec. We can remove these as well. So what else do we have? Let's just take care of the self rules. Where are the self rules? So we have the capabilities and the sockets. Copy these over and just move them up all the way on top. The self rules go all the way on top. And then just actually change this. So this netlink route socket, now it's probably reading netlink routes socket, netlink the routes routing table. So read or R netlink route or it's actually socket params, I guess. I'm not sure. If it's wrong, then the compiler will blow up. And this is just basically create socket params. If it's not right, then we'll see it. I'm just doing this from the top of my head. And we can remove these three. And then we have actually the reading these domain states of the domain's state. And so that's basically domain read all domains state iotop. And as for the getting of scheduler information, that's a guess. Domain get shed all domains. Not sure if that's right. It's just intuition, and if the policy is written in a consistent way, then this might just be right. So there are a lot of stuff that we can remove right now. So for example, this one is reading state, this is reading state, this is reading state, this is the get scheduler which we added for all domains. same for this stuff, same for this on this. Getty is also the process state, HTTPD process state, init also reading process state. Although I must say that this is probably this not enough, because see, it's also trying to get attributes, but it's getting attributes of the dir, so that's not it. That's fine. So local login, and then we have actually locale, so this is something that we need to take care of, and then the postfix processes reading state. This is all read state stuff. So now we have one rule left, which is misc files read localization. So misc files read localization, and then it's basically debugging, because yeah, I'm just translating this all from the top of my head, and so I might just have some stuff mistranslated. So let's see what if it builds, and if not, then we don't have to fix it. So here we have a domain gets, and that might be a typo actually, because it gets shed, but it gets get. If it's actually right. And it's actually right, so I guessed it right, but I made a typo in the get shed. It's with the C, but I actually see, so that's why you have, it's important that the policy is consistent and intuitive, the names, so self-documenting and consistent policy writing. So I didn't actually know what the interface, what the API would be to allow all to allow you to get scheduler information of all domains, but I know how to write consistent policy, so I just guessed. I said, okay, this is what I would call it. And that was right, because there's this standard, there's this style rule that we have, where things just need to be ordered in the way that it should be ordered. And that makes it easy for me to just guess when I see some rules, and I guess, okay, the API for that must be called that. And most of the time that just works, but sometimes if the policy writer isn't consistent and he doesn't use the consistent names, then yeah, the shit hits the fan, and then things get named not properly and stuff like that. So, and that really annoys the policy writer, because you need to basically be able to write policy from instinct pretty much. So SE module install, and then actually I can put that from my history and just install it, and then let's just see if we're clear with the ABC now, and then just try it again, and then try it in enforcing mode, and then this is a little bit of testing stage, so to speak. Yeah, takes a little while. All right, so our search, let's get that from our, we're clean, so let's just try that again. So we're still in permissive mode, so there's nothing strange going on. So yeah, basically it gets these command lines probably from proc and then PID CMD line or something like that, and then this information is probably from what was it, task, from the task file probably, I'm not sure, but I guess. Let's see what if we and we're just clean. So let's just do this in center force one. See if it works, and it works. So that's basically it. How you write a policy very, very quick. I'll search again, and it's still clean, so it just works. And we're getting force, we're enforcing, so that's fine. So now if I go away from sysadmin back to staff, but even if I would run it as root stuff, but now let's just say it's still, you see that it still craps out, see, permission is denied. But even if I, for example, sudo u root and then t staff t and role staff role and then shell and then abc123 ID. See, now I'm root in the staff domain, and if now And the weird thing is, oh yeah, so that's basically because now it's reading the bash file from root. See, root bash or C, and that's not allowed. So that's why we're getting this permission denied too. But anyways, now IOTOP will still not run. Although you're root, but you're still in the staff domain, and the staff domain is not allowed to transition from or to IOTOP domain. So that's basically how it goes. IOTOP doesn't work. So that's basically how you do it. It's just that simple.